Sources and sinks describe a very simple concept for security code reviews or finding vulnerabilities in general. Those terms are also often used in the field of taint analysis, and that's basically what we will talk about. I think it's one of these things that are super obvious, and many of you have already developed this intuitively without having a name for it. At least that was true for me, but also once I learned about the concept, this intuition transformed into an actual technique for me. So I figured there must be others that might be at a similar point and it could help. Sources and sinks, what does that mean? Sources are where data is coming from, attacker or untrustworthy sources of data. And sinks are places where untrustworthy data could do something bad. Let's do a very simple example. You have maybe seen my video, Let's Play a Game, Where's the Deadly Bug Here, where we look at a very short PHP program and I explain to you my thought process in finding the security issue. So I think it's a very good example of this concept being applied. I didn't explicitly use the terms sources and sinks in the video, but that is essentially what I did. So let's quickly identify the sources here. Sources are where data is coming from, and in this case there are three post request variables. These are fully user controlled. But data is also coming from the secret environment variable. So in terms of security, we have to think now, is that particular source relevant to us? And in the video, I was contemplating about that, but determined an attacker has probably no control over it. So I excluded it from my mental list of attacker controlled inputs. The sink in this case is pretty obvious. It's this dangerous exec function. And now we have to figure out how or if sources are connected to the sinks. If we find the connection between attacker-controlled input, the sources, to dangerous functions, the sink, then we probably have a security issue. Makes sense, right? To figure out if this is the case, it can be super easy, but in this example, it was not straightforward. I mean, the post variable, so one of the sources, is directly passed to the exec function, and that's bad, right? But it's not that simple, because before it, we have a lot of conditions that try to protect exec. In this case, the idea was to use HMAC to authenticate the command pass to exec, which means only the admin who knows the secret could do it, and the admin could also just log into the server with SSH and execute any command anyway, right? So it's not inherently a security issue. We have to prove now that an untrusted person, and in this case this means somebody who doesn't know the secret, could pass malicious code to exec. And how we figure that out, you either know already or I recommend you to watch that video. Anyway, there are a few methods how you can work with sources and sinks. For example, when you want to review some code, you could start by looking for all the dangerous functions. Let's stay with the PHP example. You could then look for every function considered dangerous. There's this really nice Stack Overflow question that collects many of them. So there are a lot of dangerous functions that are obvious, such as exec and system and eval. But the issue is, not every function is clearly dangerous. For example, there is really obscure stuff like the old PHP prec replace function, which is used to perform a regular expression search and replace, but it has this /e modifier, which can lead to PHP code execution through one of the parameters. Another example is that a developer could create or construct a dangerous setup themselves. For example, a function that creates a file and stores user data in it. But the file is also accessible from a PHP web server, and so if a user enters PHP code into that file, it could be executed by visiting that file. So you see, it's not that easy to find all the things in a program. But the concept is clear. You try to find places that could be dangerous if user-controlled input gets there. The other side, the sources are also not that easy. I mean, it's pretty obvious that get and post parameters are user-controlled, but some inputs are not clear. For example, my Wi-Fi name is a simple XSS test, and in one video where devices was listing my Wi-Fis, it caused an XSS. The developer did not anticipate that the Wi-Fi name could be malicious input. And especially with frameworks that abstract away a lot of stuff, it sometimes is really not clear what exactly is user controlled. Which means it's like the thing, it's not something you can always just search for, but the concept is clear. We want to find all the sources of untrustworthy data. And then we try to put sources and sinks together. You can either do it forwards, backwards, or a combination of both. Forwards means you take one of your sources and you just follow where this data is going. Essentially, you try to taint analysis by hand. okay, this input is then split at a comma, the first element is passed to this function, the second element is passed to this function, and then you continue to look at both functions. Along the way, you remember all the transformations of the input or sanitizations, like if certain characters are removed or what kind of checks exist, and you hope it eventually leads to a dangerous sync. The backwards path means you take a dangerous sync and try to follow the path back up. Where is this data coming from? What kind of checks have to be true in order to lead down here? And you try to figure out if it leads to a source of untrusted data. And which method to use totally depends on the target. For example, if you have code with a lot of command executions or SQL queries, then looking backwards from all the syncs could be too much and it would be easier to just follow the 5 inputs. But maybe it's easy to find all the dangerous syncs, but just the input is not very clear, so you try to track back. So deciding what to do is very much just a bit of experience and a lot of gut feeling. So the concept of sources and syncs is very easy, and I think this methodology when talking about vulnerabilities is very useful. So next time you have to find a vulnerability in some code for a class assignment or a CTF, try to use a method like this here. One other thing I want to mention is that it appears to me that the concept of sources and syncs is used a lot more in the client-side web security community than in other areas, especially in the area of DOM XSS. So you have like classic XSS where the server code places untrusted data into the generated HTML sent to the browser, but in DOM XSS it's not like that. Some untrusted input is passed to some JavaScript function and that leads to JS code execution. For example, if an attacker can control the content passed to the JavaScript function inner HTML, which will write HTML, then of course you can write a script tag as well which is executed. And because there are so many JavaScript frameworks being used with weird stuff, it's a typical thing for researchers to share syncs with each other. So you find a lot of lists of sources and syncs for various frameworks. I like this kind of sharing and would love to see it being more adapted to other languages as well. Documenting dangerous functions, especially when they are more obscure, is a really helpful thing. So if you are a developer and you work with some kind of framework in any language and you come across some functions that do something really fishy, can be easily misused, or are more powerful than people think, document it. Tweet about it with hashtag sync and hashtag the name of the framework or write a blog or something. That is just basic everyday research that can be really, really helpful.